U.S. intelligence says that it has information that Russia is preparing what's known as a false flag operation to create a pretext for another invasion of Ukraine. A U.S. official says there's evidence that operatives trained in urban warfare will carry out acts of sabotage against Russia's own forces in eastern Ukraine, proxy forces. The U.S. National Security Advisor says more details will be revealed within the next 24 hours. This U.S. announcement comes after a cyber attack disabled several Ukrainian government websites. Ukrainian officials say no personal data was compromised. Both the U.S. and EU are offering to help Ukraine in this investigation. And all of this is happening as Russian officials engage in some very direct finger-pointing at the United States in the wake of talks this week aimed at ending the Russia-Ukraine standoff. We're covering all of these many, many angles with Sam Kiley in Kiev. So this false flag allegation, we're hearing it from U.S. intelligence, but Ukrainians are saying the same, that Russia will, you know, sort of mounted an act of self-sabotage with its own people to make it look as though Ukrainians are attacking Russian forces as a pretext to go into Ukraine. What are they telling you?
So, Hala, on the Ukrainian false flag allegation, the intelligence people here have released through, and the government's quoting their own intelligence people, saying that in Moldova they believe or are claiming that Russian troops have been warned off of an impending attack by some kind of Ukrainian unit. They're saying that this is clearly a warning. This is Moldovan-based Russian troops. This is a sign that the Russians are organizing a false flag operation in order to justify some kind of further incursion into Ukraine. Of course, we're hearing a similar allegation coming from the United States, this time relating, according to American intelligence, to a potential false flag attack inside the Donbass area. Of course, Russia has form in this. They've used the excuse of protecting Russian-speaking nationals of Ukraine as the original invasion or supporting the original rebellion in the east of the country. And further back, there have always been strong allegations against the Kremlin for organizing false flag attacks blamed on Chechens inside Russian territory. So there is form here, and it's all against this backdrop, Hala, that the Russian Deputy Prime Minister here, who's in charge of the NATO and European Union file, is calling for more help from Europe. And this is what she told CNN.
Do you want to see now more military hardware coming in as a deterrent? Do you want to see some serious deliveries of some serious kit?
Let's make it clear that we as Ukrainians, we understand that no other nation would fight for Ukraine on its territory. But what we understand also clearly, that if Europe wants to sleep well and to feel that their democracy is safe, they should invest in Ukraine's defense. They should make sure that our army is twice as capable as it can be to deter and to fight against Russian aggression.
Why do you think he's doing this?
Well, I think, first of all, it's very much positively serves to his internal narrative. Because, look, this was the leader who has been known in his country as the one ignored by the democratic world, by somebody who has not been seen as a counterpart for the dialogue. And now, immediately, he's the leader presenting the big country, showing that he's trying to establish new spheres of influence.
So do you think he's bluffing? He's bluffed his way to international multilateral prominence. Is that really his end game? He doesn't really have any intent to send tanks into Kiev?
Well, I don't think that it's of his interest, because basically sending tanks to Kiev would be the end of his game. Of course, we could have a fully fledged war in the center of Europe, and Ukraine will fight against this aggression, but that would be his end. Nothing would follow after this military aggression, but before this military aggression, he has huge room for maneuver to raise the stakes and to play in the spheres where he is allowed to play.
Now, playing in the fields where he's allowed to play, if the recent today cyber attack, overnight cyber attack on some 70 different websites controlled by the government here in Ukraine, is going to be found to be behind been caused by Russia or encouraged or financed by Russia. That would be yet another example, in addition to the allegations of false flag attacks, of the stirring of the pot ahead of what clearly, certainly in the view of Russian, in the view of American intelligence, could be an impending attack of some kind on Ukrainian territory, Halla.
Okay, Sam, thanks very much. Lots of pots are getting stirred. I understand Matthew Chance is in Moscow. Any reaction to these allegations that Russia is preparing some sort of false flag attack on its own forces to justify an invasion of Ukraine?
No, I mean, there hasn't been a direct response to that. But, I mean, you know, from throughout the course of the day, there's been a long running press conference underway with Sergei Lavrov, the Russian foreign minister. And he's been sort of adding to the general sort of sense of pessimism about the outcome of the week long negotiations in Geneva, in Brussels and in Vienna to try and address security issues in Europe, particularly those core Russian demands about an end to NATO expansion and the withdrawal of military forces in NATO countries that joined the military alliance after the fall of the Soviet Union. What Lavrov is saying is that he wants now a written response in detail, identifying what works for the West and the United States, what doesn't work, possible ways forward as well. He said that even though there were a number of compromises that were floated by US officials and by NATO and the OSCE in terms of, for instance, reviving a missile treaty in Europe or, rolling back on, you know, the extent of NATO maneuvers near Russia's border, that wasn't going to be acceptable for Russia. They say they were serious. He says that Russia is serious about those core demands circulating around NATO expansion and making sure Ukraine never joins that military alliance. In terms of that claim, that allegation that Russia is preparing a false flag attack. Well, I mean, this wasn't a reaction to it, but, you know, Russia is also saying that this whole crisis in Ukraine is being used as a pretext by the United States, by NATO, in order to build up its strength in the region as well. Take a listen to what Sergei Lavrov had to say about that issue.
We have reason to believe that those statements made with great pomp in the West, that if Russia does not submit to the West, to the Western demands about what it should do with its own troops and its own territory, which is absurd, then in the next 2 or 3 months, the West will step up its rapid response force and its operations next to our border.
All right, so both sides now accusing each other of playing a double game and using this crisis as a fig leaf for their own military intentions. I mean, look, when it comes to deciding which next steps the Russians are going to take, we've heard these very pessimistic lines coming from not just Sergei Lavrov, but other Russian officials who have spoken on the issue as well over the course of the past 24 hours. The truth is, though, we haven't heard anything from Vladimir Putin yet, the Russian president, and he is the one individual that will decide whether there is enough there in terms of compromises to pursue more talks in the weeks and in the months ahead with the West and with the United States, or whether, you know, he pulls an end to this, pulls Russia out of these talks and potentially goes for a military technical response, as he's characterized it. Halla.
Why would it be in Russia's interest right now to invade Ukraine further? I mean, the country's suffering from sanctions and Vladimir Putin's own popularity is down. What would the strategic reason be?
I don't know, except for, you know, Russia has set out that it has these national security concerns. It is worried, it says, that it is being encircled by the Western military alliance, that the countries that were up until very recently a part of what it regarded as its sphere of influence have been absorbed into Western institutions. So we're talking about former Eastern Bloc countries. And over the many years since the collapse of the Soviet Union in the early 1990s, Russia has seen its global power eroded. It has seen client states around the region overthrown, like Iraq, like Libya, places like that, the pro-Russian governments toppled. And it wants to draw a line in the sand. It already did that with Syria, and it's doing it now when it comes to Ukraine.
Okay, Matthew Chance, thanks very much. Live in Moscow, and Sam Kiley in Kiev.